Would a cartoon character with any other voice sound just as real? Pitiful.
Hey, kid, you need help. And old Baloo's gonna learn you to fight like a bear.
Hey, kid, you need help. And old Baloo's gonna learn you to fight like a bear.
Hey, kid, you need help. And old Baloo's gonna learn you to fight like a bear.
Hey, kid, you need help. And old Baloo's gonna learn you to fight like a bear.
In the recipe for Disney animation, the voice is a vital spice for bringing characters to life. Whether it's Phil Harris just being himself.
That's all I can be, because I could never do dialects, no kind of dialect. It's just that, I don't do impressions, you know. Or I don't do dishes or windows, you know, it's just, that's me.
Or Will Ryan, a voice man who can do a whole spectrum of colorful dialects.
Hiya, pal. Looks like you're having fun bouncing.
Of course I am. After all, tiggers just love bouncing, because bouncing's what tiggers do best.
Tigger, would you please stop this silly bouncing? It's very annoying.
Oh, come on, Rabbit. Be a sport. Say, could I bounce too?
Oh, no. No. No, Willie, please. Don't bounce. Oh!
The unique voices behind the animated cartoons stem from the unique personalities of the people who perform them. You'll meet and hear many of these animation voices in the Disney Family Album.
Big Mama, you better lose a few pounds.
Disney artists always record the voice first, literally drawing inspiration from the actor doing the character's voice. For The Fox and the Hound, Pearl Bailey was cast as Big Mama, and her voice performance helped inspire the owl's personality, as you can see from Frank Thomas's animation.
When you listen to the voice, the one thing you're looking for is a voice that sounds spontaneous and full of character, something where you see, as an animator, you see expressions, you see attitudes, you see all these things just by listening to the voice.
In 1928, Steamboat Willie became the first sound cartoon, and Walt Disney became the first cartoon voice man. For the next 20 years, he would play the role of Mickey Mouse. In 1946, sound effects expert Jimmy McDonald took over the role from Disney.
10, 20, 30, 40. Boy, what a lifeline. Oh, I can't believe it.
And 30 years later, Jimmy's protege, Wayne Allwine, became the voice of the famous mouse.
Why, Merry Christmas, Mr. Scrooge. Why, Mr. Scrooge, Merry Christmas. Won't you come in?
Mickey. Here's my speaking voice. I go up a little bit higher and a little bit higher and, oh boy, there he is, right there.
Allwine's elastic voice is heard as four other characters in Mickey's Christmas Carol.
It's a kind of nasal sound like this, and he's a cockney. Right? So we close your nose up a bit like that and you talk like this.
Oh, well, let's rest a minute before we fill it in, eh? But he ain't going nowhere.
That's a weasel.
Give a penny for the poor, Governor. A penny for the poor, Governor. A penny for the poor.
Working with Allwine on Mickey's Christmas Carol was a who's who of cartoon voices. Men like veteran Hal Smith, who's never grown out of the childhood habit of doing funny voices.
I've always done voices, you know. You do that from the time you're a kid. I would hear people and I would... somebody would come in with a strange voice like, with an accent.
Hello there, what is going on? So I used to listen to them for a while, and the first thing I knew, oh boy, I was doing it too.
Scrooge McDuck. Ebenezer Scrooge. Oh, there's no hope. I'm doomed. Doomed.
And the same thing will happen to you, Ebenezer Scrooge.
Will Ryan explains his multifaceted voice this way.
In order to do these cartoon voices properly, you have to be able to think like a cartoon character. You have to be able to seem like a total nincompoop, or the biggest villain who ever walked the face of the earth, or a frightened rabbit, you know. I've done all of those things for a living.
For Mickey's Christmas Carol, Ryan had to think like the mental midget Willie the Giant.
And don't forget the chocolate pot roast with the smash you. With the smash you. With the splash you. With the spiggle. With yogurt.
And like the villainous Black Pete.
Why, yours, Ebenezer. The richest man in the cemetery.
And he continues laughing and has a great time.
For the miserly Scrooge McDuck, actor Alan Young called on his own Scottish ancestry.
I was born in Tynemouth and moved to Edinburgh when I was about 6 years old, raised in a Scottish community, and I fought to get rid of my accent when I came to America. And now I can get it back fairly easily.
My partner, Jacob Marley, dead 7 years today.
Oh, he was a good un. He left me enough money to pay for his tombstone.
And I had him buried at sea.
Oh, he'd have been proud of me.
Paul Winchell is one of today's kings of cartoon voicing, but it was his ventriloquism act with pal Jerry Mahoney that brought him to Hollywood.
Reading Edgar Bergen's book is what taught me the rudiments of ventriloquism. Actually, if I could say it quickly, it's applying pressure with your diaphragm and actually squeezing out the voice. If I speak this way, the voice seems to come here.
Hello, hello, what are you doing there? Hello, what are you doing there?
The moment you put pressure on it, it could be here.
Hello, hello.
Or over here.
Hello, hello.
So the pressure is what gives you the illusion of the throwing of the voice.
Hollywood offered Winchell other places to throw his voice around. He became the original voice of the one-of-a-kind critter called Tigger.
Hello, I'm Tigger.
Oh,
glad to meet you. Name's Tigger. T-I-double-G-R. That spells Tigger.
Tigger was an extremely rambunctious kind of a guy with an awful lot of enthusiasm in his voice and silly at the same time and full of laughter. So I came up with a, hey, look at that guy staring at me in the mirror. He's wearing pajamas.
What a strange-looking creature. Look at those beady little eyes and that preposterous chin.
Looked like another Tigger to me.
Oh, no, it's not. I'm the only Tigger. Watch me scare the stripes off of this imposter.
I even wrote one line just by ad-libbing. Every time when he left Winnie, he would say, well, TTFN, ta-ta for now. And he'd fly out of the screen.
TTFN, ta-ta for now.
Sterling Holloway has recorded more voices for Disney animated features than anyone else. The character that's closest to him is the stuffed bear come to life, Winnie the Pooh.
And that's one of my very favorite characters. Also, it was Disney's favorite character. And he spent an awful lot of money on that one particular Pooh Bear.
Oh, hello. Am I glad to see you? It's more friendly with two. Now, you go that way, and I'll go this way.
Holloway's voice was always the same, but each characterization was a unique performance. His was the voice of the stork in Dumbo.
Here is a baby with eyes of blue, straight from heaven, right to you.
Alice in Wonderland's Cheshire Cat.
You may have noticed that I'm not all there myself.
And wrote for the mouse in The Aristocats. Mm.
Did somebody say cheese?
Sterling Holloway never knew what Walt Disney was going to cast him as next.
Walt came to me and he was such a stickler for voices. He said, when you finished what you're doing today on Winnie the Pooh, he said, fiddle around, see what you can do with a snake. He said, I can't get the right voice. So I thought, wouldn't it be funny to have a snake with an aching back, because it would be such a long ache.
The result? The slithering, scene-stealing car in the Jungle Book.
Just you wait till I get you in my coils. Ugh. This is going to slow down my slithering.
A good voice, man, is hard to find.
I won't say a good cartoon voice, because there are many people who think that what you want to do is get a funny, you know, talking, you know, a funny placement of the voice. You don't want that. You want a voice which sounds real, sincere.
Sincere voices became a necessity when Disney began production on his first animated feature. The voices of Snow White's seven dwarfs had to peg them as seven individual personalities. Animator Ward Kimball's unique collection of Disneyana includes this 1937 screen guide.
And inside are all of the personalities who did the voices. And in some case, we would use them for inspiration, and we'd film them. Now, Lionel Atwell did Doc.
Why, yeah, that's true.
And Billy Gilbert did Sneezy.
Look, Goldenrod.
Don't do it. Take him away. By dose. By hay fever. You know I can't stand it. I can't. Thanks.
And Pino Kolbig, who worked at the studio, not only did the voice for Goofy, but he did the voice for Grumpy.
Oh, you must be Grumpy.
Yeah.
We know who we are. Ask her who she is and what she's doing here.
Yeah. What are you and who are you doing? What are you? Who are you, my dear?
Oh, how silly of me. I'm Snow White.
The most important Snow White voice was the leading role. Adrianna Caselotti was 18 years old in 1935 when, quite by accident, she got the call to play Snow White.
My father was a singing teacher here in Los Angeles, and one day one of the Walt Disney representatives called his studio and asked if he knew of a little girl who could sing and speak like a child. And I was listening in on the extension phone upstairs, and I said, Papa, how about me? And I went, and I said, I can talk like a little girl, too. So I came up with a makeup voice. I did not have that little girl voice. I made it up. And this is the reason I can still do this. I'm wishing for the one I love to find today.
Today.
Oh.
Hello.
Snow White was the only role Adrianna Caselotti ever played. But another young Disney star had a flourishing film career. Child actor Dick Jones appeared in over 200 movies.
I did a lot of westerns because I could do all my own writing, and they didn't have to double me. And I played almost every big-name star as a boy.
The most famous boy Dick Jones played was one made of wood. He was the voice of Pinocchio.
The things that stand out in my mind were like when they did Ty Diddley D, An Actor's Life for Me. They built this set with a rolling road, put us in costume, and then we had to go dancing along the road singing, "Hi, diddly-dee, an actor's life for me."
On to the theater. Hi, diddly-dee, an actor's life for me. A high silk hat and a silver cane. A watch of gold with a diamond chain. Hi, diddly-dee, an actor's life for me. It's great to be a celebrity. An actor's life for me.
Dick Jones discovered doing a cartoon voice for Disney can be hazardous to your health.
Trying to figure out how to make your voice sound like you're underwater. They tried to get me to put some water in my mouth and talk and couldn't do it. So they laid me down on my back and poured water in my mouth and almost drowned me. Then somebody came up with an idea of using like a squirrel cage with paddles in it, talking to a megaphone, and they turned it and it came out blub, 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 blub like that.
For his version of Alice in Wonderland, Disney needed another child's voice, this time a little girl. Disney found his Alice in Kathryn Beaumont, a child actress transplanted from England and today a grade school teacher in Toluca Lake, California.
Yes, I was familiar with the story long before it was going to be filmed. I had read it when I was still in England, and I knew the character quite well.
If I had a world of my own, everything would be nonsense. Nothing would be what it is, because everything would be what it isn't. And what it wouldn't be, it would. You see?
Ow! Like many of the Disney voices, Kathryn Beaumont gave more than her vocal cords in the line of duty. As an aide to the animators, she was filmed in many of the curious situations Alice found herself in.
When I was coming down the rabbit hole, for instance, they put me in a stirrup as if it was a horse. And I sat on that with the Alice dress draped over it. And then one of the prop men would rock it so that it would look as if I was floating down the rabbit hole and sort of teetering back and forth as I was passing through the air.
Through the center of... And come out the other side where people walk upside down. Oh, but that's silly. Nobody...
Kathryn has fond memories of recording the voice of Alice and of her Wonderland co-stars.
I know the tea party sequence for me was a delight because of working with Ed Wynn and Jerry Colonna. You know, Ed Wynn had such a sense of humor, and he would always make it lively and sort of entertaining at the same time. So they were fun sequences. They were fun days.
Would you like a little more tea?
Well, I haven't had any yet, so I can't very well take more.
Ah, you mean you can't very well take less? Won't you tell us all about it?
Start at the beginning.
Yeah, yeah. And when you come to the end, stop.
Bye.
Disney was so pleased with Kathryn's voice, he cast her as another British heroine.
When I was ready to do Wendy in Peter Pan, I believe I was about 12 or 13, so I was beginning to reach that same stage that Wendy had reached, so it was just the right timing for me. She babbled. I mean, you know, she was going through that stage where she was, her feelings, she was excited about things, and so she showed her excitement through her chatter.
But what I still don't understand is how Nana got it in the first place. She really isn't... Oh, sit down. It won't take long. She really isn't vicious, you know. She's a wonderful nurse. Although Father says...
Girls talk too much.
Yes. Girls talk too...
Many Disney characters demanded a subtle charm. Television gave Disney one of the most uniquely charming voices ever, Eva Gabor.
Well, I was doing Green Acres at the time, and they just called me, and they said, would you like to do it? And I said, anything for Disney, of course I would like to do it.
As Duchess, the feminine feline in the Aristocats, Eva Gabor first tried to bring out the cat in herself.
My conception of this animated, brilliant movies was that I have to become a cat. Well, I mean, we all women have little cat in ourselves, but it was absolutely the different all way around. These brilliant artists of yours just listened and watched. And when I went back a few months later, the first draft of this cat was me.
You just
So from that on, I just played the scene the way I wanted it, and they captured my movements, my personality, and everything there is. They're incredible people.
Bravo! Very good. You are a great talent.
Well, thank you. And what might your name be?
My name is Duchess.
In spite of her fear of mice, Eva next agreed to give voice to Miss Bianca, the world's smallest secret agent in The Rescuers. Eva soon realized she had a kindred spirit in the mouse.
I could not relate as well to a mice as to a cat until I saw the first scene. And as she walked in, and I have this habit of always doing this, she did the same thing, this little mouse, and then she took up a powder box and powdered her nose like I always do. I fell in love with that mouse.
Miss Bianca, be sure it's fastened good and tight.
I can't. It'll wrinkle my dress.
And here we go!
Eva Gabor's leading man in the Aristocats was Phil Harris as O'Malley the Alley Cat.
That's right, and I'm very proud of that. Yeah.
He was a cat, and he was an alley cat. You know, he liked to get around, liked to go dancing, you know, liked the young girls and everything. There's nothing wrong in that, is there?
When Walt Disney cast him as a voice in The Jungle Book, Harris was sure he couldn't play a Rudyard Kipling brand bear.
I get this call, and they said, we want you to come out the studio, and they said, we want you to play the part of the bear, Baloo, in Jungle Book. And I said, I can't do it. It just doesn't feel natural, and I left. About a week later, I get a call again. They said, Phil, Mr. Disney says that you're the guy he wants for that bear. Will you please try it again? So, but anyway, I go back again, and I said, there's no need for me to try that the way it is. They said, well, Phil, what do you suggest? I don't know what made me say it. I said, well, do you mind if I do it the way I would do it? And they said, go ahead and try it. I said, look, kid, you keep fooling around in here with these animals. Why, that monkey will eat you, you know. I mean, you get your roof knocked in, you know. And the guy said, that's exactly what we want.
Hey, kid. Come on, that's it.
The breezy lingo of band leader Harris turned Baloo the bear from a supporting player into the star of the film.
You better believe it. Now, let's go once more. Now, I want you to keep circling or I'm going to knock your roof in again. You better keep moving. Ooh. Hey, right on the button.
Unique and memorable voices that create character are a tradition at Disney, a tradition that continues in their animated feature, The Black Cauldron.
Are you coming?
Me? Go in there? Oh, no, no, no. It's a terrible place.
This sword and sorcery adventure fantasy not only features some way-out characters, but some pretty way-out voices, including John Byner's voice creation for Gurgi.
I was shown the storyboard, or as much as they had, about this lovable little character who always liked to eat and would do anything, you know, to get what he wanted to. And he sounded like a fun guy, you know, so I just added a little bit of, I guess you'd call a child's inflection on what he had to say, rather than say,
You want some munchings and crunchings, because I'm very hungry, I said.
I said.
I want some munchings and crunchings, because I'm very hungry. It's like that. So, that's the way it is, because she's a little younger, that's all.
Oh, poor miserable Gurgi deserves fierce smackings and whackings on his poor tender head. I was left with no munchings and crunchings.
Now look here. Have you seen my pig?
Piggy? Round? Fat piggy? Big snout?
Yes, yes.
Corner tail?
That's her. That's Henwin.
Nope. Gurgi not see piggy.
The Black Cauldron's sinister villain, the Horned King, called for a voice dripping with evil. The call was answered by British actor John Hurt.
They wanted me to do that part.
It's often a certain amount of bemusement for an actor as to why you get chosen for a part. And he was such a loathsome creature. I seem to dredge a voice from somewhere, from the bowels of the earth, I think, was the general idea.
I presume, my boy, you are the keeper of this oracular pig.
Yes, sir.
Then instruct her to show me the whereabouts of the Black Cauldron. It was very hard to speak, if you see what I mean. It was all dredged from somewhere. The Black Cauldron, so it does exist. Go on. Yes, yes. Where is it? Show me. Show me.
Perhaps the sentiment of John Byner speaks for all the memorable voices, from Mickey Mouse to Gurgi, that live forever in the wonderful world of Disney animation.
I've always loved the characters, and they've been part of my life. I mean, Bambi and Thumper and go on and on and on. I mean, for what it did to me, or for me as a child, I can only hope that something like that will happen to somebody else from what I've done. I mean, I sat there and I cried, and I sat there and I laughed, and I felt joy, and I knew that everybody in the world could feel the same thing from the same thing that was happening on the screen.